going to take an immediate break from the project I'm currently working on and nearing completion of to address this latest flack about the Shirley Sherrod firing. Although I'm about a day late in having been made aware of this, I still feel that it is important to address because it touches upon a couple of key issues which need to be analyzed and scrutinized, and they both concern President Barack Obama and how he factors into the equation. First, Ms. Sherrod's declarations and observations.
Back in San Diego, Ms. Sherrod also addressed comments in which she said that younger African Americans needed to brush up on the civil rights struggles that their ancestors faced. She even said the president was among those in need of a history lesson.
Those of us who were in the civil rights struggle from 50 years or more ago were hurt in many, many, many ways. We tried, I think, too much to shield that hurt and pain from younger people. So many of them don't know their history. And I really think we have to do a better job of helping those individuals who will get these positions in the media, in our educational institutions, in the presidency. We have to make sure they understand the history so that they can do a better job in the positions that they have to help move all of us.
I literally clapped my hands when it was announced that Ms. Sherrod was contemplating suing Andrew Dimbulb, I'm assuming, for defamation. And I loved her resolve to never appear on the fixed news channel. Where is this kind of determination from others in defiance against the right-wing smear machine? I was especially supportive of Ms. Sherrod's call to educate our current president with some deeper facts about the histories and lasting painful memories of America's civil rights struggles, which Barack Obama is clearly significantly out of touch with. It all harkens back to my early caveats to the African-American community about getting too wrapped up in the fact that Barack Obama was classified as a black man, or more specifically, a half-black man, because Barack Hussein Obama is not, nor has he grown up as, or with the experiences of, an African-American. Our experience was not his experience. Our history is not his history. Therefore, regardless of how fully immersed he may have tried to become into the mind, culture, and issues associated with the black community in America, he could never fully understand or appreciate our challenges and our struggles, because he will necessarily be lacking a key component which will always prevent him from fully understanding and relating to the realities of what it has historically meant to be, quote, African American, unquote. Obama's greatest problem, however, is his abject willingness to allow himself to be cowered and walked over, and his lack of resolve to stand firm in the face of enemy opposition.
Meanwhile, at the Urban League in Washington this morning, President Obama said it was time for all Americans to learn from the controversy, in which he said Ms. Sherrod was an innocent victim.
She deserves better than what happened last week. When a bogus controversy based on selective and deceiving excerpts of a speech led to her forced resignation. Now, many are to blame for the reaction and overreaction that followed these comments, including my own administration. And what I said to Shirley was that the full story she was trying to tell, a story about overcoming our own biases and recognizing ourselves and folks who on the surface seem different, is exactly the kind of story we need to hear in America. It's exactly what we need to hear because we've all got our biases. And rather than jump to conclusions and point fingers and play some of the games that are played on cable TV. We should all look inward and try to examine what's in our own hearts. And play some of the games that are played on cable TV, cable TV, cable TV, cable TV, cable TV, cable TV, cable TV. Cable TV.
Why were you afraid to come right out and say Fox News, Mr. President? Why were you terrified to call out this den of America-hating racist bigots and corporate elitists exactly for who and what they truly are? This is precisely why Barack Obama is perceived as being a weak president. James Earl Carter, the nation's 39th president, and almost universally viewed as the weakest among our contemporary presidents, had more gonads than what we've been witnessing with our 44th president. Obama starts off big with a loud bark, standing majestic on the front porch, only to scurry away later to the backyard with barely an audible whimper. He champions all these causes the American citizenry truly cares about, then backpedals under pressure from pure dyed-in-the-wool obstructionists trying to negotiate with a pack of hyenas who don't even know the meaning of the word compromise. When somebody steps on his neck, he pleads with them for how he can reposition himself so that his assailant doesn't sprain the ligaments in his toes. It's really quite sad when you consider that Shirley Sherrod is a woman, and yet she has bigger stones than the top office holder in the nation. U.S. presidents are supposed to be strong and resilient, and especially inspirational. The fact that he had selected Joseph Biden to be his running mate was, for me, the first indication of his questionable level of seriousness to take this job on properly and with the raw determination that was needed. His Supreme Court nominations should be giving us even clearer insight into his lack of understanding the stakes that we're playing for, despite all of his tough talk sprinkled with intellectualism. If the Democrats want any suggestions as to whom they should consider putting up to run against him in the 2012 elections, need I say more? Talented 10th.